finish at the gym. This is world champion Fallon Taylor.
Hey.
We got her mama here with us in the car. We're doing some interviews. We are getting behind the scenes, down and dirty, with the world champion barrel racer Fallon Taylor. I've asked you guys to submit questions via Instagram, and we have a lot of really great questions. And interestingly enough, these are questions that I really wanted the answers to as well. So I think that there are a lot of people that are going to gain value from this. So the first question is from the Lady Lawless, and she wants to know, what is something you wish you had started doing sooner? Something that you had done years ago that would have helped put you in the position you are in now, but earlier. Along the same lines, what are something that you would have realized sooner from a mental standpoint?
I think that as I look back over my life, every setback or mishap or unfortunate, tragic thing that has happened has been the thing to catapult me to the next level. What I wish that I would have done was not wait for tragedy to strike before I demanded a new standard of myself. So I wish that instead of waiting for my neck to be broken to get myself back in a place where I could go compete down the road and ultimately become a world champion, I wish that I hadn't just been sitting around waiting for those 15 years. What was I doing for those 15 years? And I think that whatever you believe in, whether it be God or Source or the universe or Buddha or whoever it is that you pray to, that energy has to line up to shock you into the next level if you do have a growth mindset. And it would be a lot more beneficial to you for you to sit down and write down what you want and then go after it than to wait for that thing to strike, because the bad things are coming. You can expect a problem about once every 3 months. It's just how life goes. And I think that I always thought that I was trying to play it safe so that I could avoid problems. And it does not matter what scale you're on, the problem will always arise. Whether it be that you have $20 in the bank and your car blows up, or you've got $1 million in the bank and somebody sues the pants off of you. Whatever that may be, the problem will arise, and it's scalable to whatever your situation is. The other thing that I wish I'd have done it, and I did it at the same time, just not as quickly, but I really enjoyed a lot of things leisure-wise that have absolutely no impact on my income, my goals, my family, my friends, and I wish that I never really had a favorite TV show. I wish that I, never really took those days to listen to the radio and just listen to music. While I think it's super important that we take some time for social interaction, which I'm just now learning to do, is take mandatory minutes of the day for social interaction, I would have done a lot less way back when. There's nothing notable that will come out of you being the yes man in the room, to be just the person that just goes with everybody as they just go through their day. It's a lot harder to be the guy that says, no, I have crap to do today, and go on and educate yourself. And I'm the generation that had a phone with a cord on it in the kitchen, then to a cordless phone, then to a cell phone, and all those changes happened in my generation. And I think everybody's got such an advantage because they were born with a smartphone in their hand, so they have access to all the information they could possibly want. Where I remember having a library card and having to seek that out and being the weirdo or the nerd to go do that. Now it's socially acceptable to just be on your phone, listen to some YouTube videos. People are monetizing that, so they want you to watch. They're making really great footage for you to watch. And those are things that I would have done different.
Okay, I'm glad you brought up YouTube, because this next question comes from one of the most impressive 16-year-olds I think I've ever seen.
I've heard about her.
Okay, so this is Barrel Racer for Life, and she says, Fallon, I'd love to start my own Western clothing company to go along with her blog, It's a Cowgirl's Life, and possibly start a YouTube channel. I'm 16 years old. What's some advice you can give me when first starting a business and YouTube channel? If you guys haven't checked it out already, you totally should. She's incredible.
I think that she actually sent me some stuff, I want to say. That kind of rings the bell. First of all, so proud of you. I know that you can do it. Anything that you work every single day at, you can do. You never want to be the big idea guy in the room. You want to be the quiet, silent worker in the corner. Big idea guy talks about it, tells you all about it, and doesn't do anything. And the hard worker in the corner with their head down in a book, on the internet, researching things constantly, that's the person that will pass you by. And I just think everything relates to like the story of the tortoise and the hare. you said you possibly want to start a YouTube channel. Start a YouTube channel. It's free. You can do it today. You can start a YouTube channel in the next 15 minutes. Take that massive action and just go ahead and do it. One thing that I didn't do was leave my YouTube channel alone and leave everybody without a lot of vital information. And it's the place where I can connect to you guys the most. So I can add the most value in YouTube, and that's why I'm starting to go back to that. Starting a business, same thing. Go to YouTube. Go to any of these places and get information. How to start a clothing line. How to form my own LLC. How to structure a business. What kind of taxes am I going to have to pay? And then the next step is get a mentor. Finding a mentor would be my number one task for you behind just popping up a YouTube channel really quick and just making a short 5-minute video for everyone. But anything you do with diligence and patience and consistency every single day of your life, you will succeed at. It may just turn into something different as you go.
That's awesome. I think that's important for me to keep in mind also is that I have an idea of what I want to be doing, but I need to be flexible and open-minded. And
it will morph. Whatever exactly. You think that you will be doing, in order for me to get to where I owned a $1 million clothing company, it started out with me and my mom making cell phone cases, you know, in my living room and her living room, like gluing our fingers together and just trying to figure out and constantly experimenting with what do people like, how can I add value to their life, what is it that they really want, instead of thinking that you have a really great idea and putting everything into it. Ask people what they want and then build that for them. I think that's super important.
That's awesome. So this next question is kind of in the position where I'm in right now too, so I'd love to get your input on this. It comes from Lauren L. Ray, and she wants to know, how and when do you know it's time to quit that 9-to-5 job and hit the pro rodeo world? I've honestly cried over it over and over again, trying to figure out how I'm going to handle a job and rodeo at the same time. I even have college being pushed in my face, and I know I should go get a degree in something, but that's not fueling my dream.
Knowing why you want to do something will make all the stars align. Why do you want to do it? And you have to keep that in your forefront of your mind all the time. I want to turn pro this year in bikini championships. I'll tell you this story really quickly because it does relate. I'm starting to feel guilty because I'm spending less time at the ranch. I'm starting to feel guilty because I'm turning out of some rodeos that I would really like to run at. But I went back to my notebook last night, and on my notebook said, top 50 in the world in the PRA standings, which I will be, and I will rodeo in the fall to be top 50. It does not say go win the world, so I can't be guilty about that. It says go win your pro card in the bikini championships, so I have to dedicate more time to that. It says find a relationship that has some fulfillment. It says spend a ton of time with my mom and dad. It says buy these vehicles, earn this money. It says invest in your future. I have certain dollar amounts that I want to do that. And all of those things, in order to say yes to that list, I'm going to feel guilty and have to say no to a lot of things over here. And so I'm not going to go to a rodeo tomorrow because it does not line up with these things that will ultimately make this list come in. And I can't feel guilty about that. So whomever's day it ruins that I'm going this way, that's just too bad. It's got to stay in line. So Jenna had this problem when she had a 9-to-5, and she would just look at me and constantly say, I just don't know. You know, I can't afford anything. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know how I'm going to pay my bills. Step one is write down the exact dollar amount you think you're going to need for that year. Take some massive action. Sit your butt down. I know someone that in business doesn't sit down and do the numbers first and always ends up in a pickle. Always. Because you dream up some great idea. I want to go to the NFR. I want to go pro rodeo. And I'm going to quit everything. I'm going to give everything for this thing. But you never knew what it actually was going to take. And it may change your why a little bit. You know, like my why, I'm going to be in Vegas with my family and have fans there. Well, was my why to qualify to the NFR before to try to attract fans to me and sign autographs? If that was my ultimate why, then I really don't need a qualification to get that same reward, that same payoff. So if I'm looking at going down the road, there's a simple math equation that you can do, and you add a value to things on your phone. So say we were talking about job A and job B. Job A is a 9-to-5, it pays $40,000 a year, $50,000 a year. Let's just say $50,000 a year, you have a solid income, you can pay your insurance, et cetera, et cetera, but your fulfillment is in the tank. So let's say you have 100% job security, but you have 20% fulfillment. We can do the math and say you have, you know, your relationships kind of tank, so 30% debt. That job's worth about 50% of your quality of life to you. But let's say you have 100% fulfillment with a 20% income, but you can make up those other margins. You can do the math on a calculator really quickly and see which direction you need to go. And you can add a value to anything in your life. Like, it means about, you know, let's say 10% of my life is having a relationship. Or maybe for you, it's 70% of my life is being able to stay home and maintain a relationship. It depends to you, and you put a value to those things, and then you're a little bit more clear on which direction you want to go. Jenna, for her, I said, map out what kind of money you would need. Let's realistically talk about it. It cost me about $1,000 a rodeo to go to a rodeo in the state of Texas. So to go to two rodeos this week would cost me about $2,000. That's with fees, time away, all of those things. And you never count your earnings toward an income. You will never win as much as you spend, ever. So making sure that you're keeping those winnings out of your head and just knowing what this is going to cost you will take a lot of pressure out of you as a competitor. So you just know that that money is never coming back to you. You will win money at some point, but it's just going to go straight to that gas money. So writing down a number for what that's going to cost you for the year, say you want to go to 20 rodeos next year, adding up in the WPRA Sports News how much those entry fees are going to cost, how much fuel is going to cost. You can use MapQuest, has got a little gas calculator. You have to double that number. It's inaccurate, but you can at least get a roundabout value. What are stalls going to cost me? What's my Coggins and Health going to cost me? My feed on the road, my hay, my insurance, my tires, my oil change money, and I need to have about 500 just in case of something happening. And you add that up and say you want to go to 20 rodeos, then you figure out what that budget is, and it's probably a lot smaller number or maybe a lot bigger number than you were thinking. And go find a way to use to be creative and be entrepreneurial about getting that money on the side. You have the same 24 hours in your day as I do, and if that means that in order to pay my trainer and pay for my food and pay for my chef, I'm not waiting for my fairy godmother to come here. I am going to stay up until 2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning and strategize a way to make more income to compensate for the things that I want to do. I may not get to sleep as much as everybody, and I may not get to watch as much TV, but I have burned the boats on my backup plan. There's no backup plan. I am going this way. So a lot of numbers are involved in figuring out how to ditch the 9-to-5. And it is so rewarding and so fulfilling. And I work 25 times more than I ever did when I had any sort of job. So if you think it's easier, a lot of people are, you know, if they get homeschooled, they think it's so much easier than regular school. And they don't realize you do it around the clock. So that's my extremely long answer for ditch your 9-to-5.
But I think that's perfect. I mean, you did a great job of breaking it down. And especially for my analytical mind, thinking about fulfillment and income and how you're going to break that down. Like, what's important to you? Like,
fulfillment is such a bigger part of your income than you can ever understand. And Trisha actually talked to me about, you know, let's do these clinics. And I really didn't want to do the clinics because I can't maintain any sort of normal life. And I've never really had a home where I stay at home and we do the home thing. And now that I'm 34, that's very important. If I want to have kids, I better get after it. You know, these are things that maybe I'll get fulfillment from those things. And she basically helped me set up an investment plan for if you work your ass off for the next 2 years, you probably don't have to work again. And my ultimate goal is to retire at 40. And I say retire just means I've got a lot of money in the bank to do whatever I want, which is what I'm doing now. I want to gather up my funds so that I can continue to hoard up animals and do whatever the heck I want to and pursue these really crazy goals. And I want to talk to you. I want to add something else in about goals. I think I have failed to tell people, and I'll probably make a full YouTube video about this. I think I've failed people when I talked to them about goals, and I didn't realize it until this morning. Goals with no deadline are just wishful thinking. You have to have a timeline. I want to win my pro card in bikini championships this year. I wanted to win the Fort Worth rodeo this year. My mom wants to lose 100 pounds by December. I want to retire by 40. Those are things that, you know, I want to do that are on a timeline. and very specific. I don't think I've been specific enough to tell people that without a timeline of mm-hmm. Renee wants to quit her 9-to-5 by this time next year, boom, period, dot. And I think that's super important to do, is to say, this is it. Because when you have a feeling of scarcity, like, oh my God, the sky is falling, you make miraculous crap happen that you never thought was possible from you.
The next question comes from me.
Ooh,
and I want to talk to you about building a personal brand. You have such a recognizable brand, and it's shifted and it's grown, but it's still very, very distinctly Fallon Taylor. How do other people go about discovering what their personal brand is and then really owning it and sharing that brand with others?
That's a tough question. And I was thinking about that all morning, and I didn't realize I've done a really good job. So I was kind of patting myself on the back this morning as I'm going into the next level. I'm having to like go, you did really good at this level. You did really, really good. Now start over. And that's really tough. So I've done really good to this point. And I'm reading a book right now called Disrupt You. And it's about people that took an industry and then disrupted it. So they did something totally different with that industry, and that's how they ended up branding themselves really nicely and being able to give something that people can relate to. One big thing is exposing your vulnerability, exposing the things about you that make you human. And for me, you know, I've got extensions and tan and lashes and the whole thing. What is it that makes me relatable, you know, if I, you know, present myself like a little rodeo Barbie? And the thing is I'm just like everyone else. I'm battling weight, I'm battling injury, I'm battling divorce, I'm battling all of these things, and making sure that I'm vulnerable enough for people to see that and not protect this layer and try to be somebody that's pretentious and snobby and ugly to people, that will never help anyone. As far as branding, it's really crazy, and I think that I'm maybe a branding savant, and I really don't know how to tell people to do it. So branding for me has just been, I've always looked up to people like Madonna, and people like Cher, people with longevity. And I've always looked at them. My mom knows, since I was a little bitty girl, I've been obsessed with really old movie stars. I want to be Sophia Loren, and I've had this kind of magical way of being Benjamin Button. And I did a side-by-side picture of myself when I was 24, and then now when I'm 34, and it looks like they should be like this. But I'm constantly trying to evolve as a person and then exposing what I did wrong. But with tie-dye and helmets, what's really cool that I was trying to figure out, what made me be able to do this? I'm not a genius that just sat down and was like, I know, I'm going to do this. And we talk about this all the time. I just continually change the standard. If your standard is to wear denim jeans that are dirty and ripped up, and your boots are really muddy, and your shirt's hanging off of you and it's untucked, and that's your standard, that's not good enough for me today. And my mom put that in me. And I'm not kissing her butt because she's sitting here, but she would always go, clean your boots, fix your hair. People notice this kind of thing. And she preached that to me. It wasn't until I was much older that I realized this, oh.
Mama's right, guys. That's what we just learned. Right. Mama's always right.
This will make me stand out. And then it just kept getting a little bit more like, well, if you always wear denim, then I'm going to do something different. Or now I'm expected to wear tie-dye, so I'm going to wear denim. So I'm going to go back, and I'm going to wear extremely starched, very clean, because that's the standard I have for myself. And
always reinventing.
Yeah, the helmet thing.
Was smart.
Yeah, I should have done it a long way before, but I didn't have that kind of standard for myself. Then all of a sudden I decided, wait. This could change so much. And today, right now, I was in the car on the way to the gym going, what's the new standard? I did just wake up one morning and say, we're all gonna wear denim and wild rags now, okay? And turquoise, and that's what we're gonna do because everybody's waiting for us to blow out tie-dye. And everybody got on board except for Jenna, which was really funny, which is really cool for people to know. She was like, I just really don't think that's, you know, I really like wearing the tie-dye, I just don't really feel it. And I said, let's put a photo shoot together. Everybody was really excited about it. She got in the clothes in this new standard, and she was like, this is absolutely 100% for me. This cannot go backwards. I love this. This is the way we go. So you just have to know that some people will come along and some people will kind of be a little bit hesitant, smaller. But you can change the standard of your entire group.
Your helmet campaign came from a personal experience and built your brand from a personal experience. Is that something you recommend from other people, kind of drawing from their personal lives?
Somebody asked me, I was riding in a hat the whole time I started my career back 3 years after I broke my neck. Never crossed my mind to wear a helmet. Some really great people said, hey, you like to step out and change the industry. You should wear a helmet. And I was like, I'm not going to wear a helmet. Crazy? That's insane. And then it dawned on me, I was the reluctant person in the group talking about the standard. And I'm like, if the Olympians that ride dressage horses think that it's okay, and they are so dynamic and so amazing, and they're just trotting around, surely I can compromise and do this, and what kind of ripple effect would it have? And then, of course, my style is very showman, so of course I wanted to wait and make this big giant splash at the NFR when the ground was bad, when I couldn't make a public statement about how bad the ground was, and to put that thing on and just go, I'm not gonna say a word, don't worry. Click. And then I ran in there and everyone knew why I had done that. The timing was just really beautiful. Perfect. On that. And perfect. The ripple effect, after I ran, and then I don't run social media when I'm in Las Vegas. I don't touch it, don't look at it. You just can't handle that much pressure and criticism. I literally delete the apps from my phone. I have no idea. I handed my phone off and everybody came running to the trailer and they were like, you've changed the entire barrel racing industry in one run. And I sent Stormy around and Katarina buying up every helmet in Las Vegas so that I would have Jesse, and they were spray painting them in the room
to
match every outfit that night. I'd have to take it into the room and spray paint it, and have them come out so that helmet I won the world in chips off paint into red paint everywhere. So it's pretty wild.
That's amazing. And I love that you've always been able to look at different industries and kind of learn from them and draw from them. Like, you don't have to just look at other barrel racers to learn about your craft. Like, I love watching Clinton Anderson movies because think he is one of the most impressive horsemen that we've ever seen. And I also love that, you know, you just mentioned, you know, dressage horses and jumping horses. Those guys are Olympic athletes. Like, you think they know what they're doing on horses? You better believe they do. One of my very best friends is a show jumper, and I tell you what, I have so much respect for that industry. So I think it's something that is so amazing that you've been able to, in business as well, learn from all walks of life, all different industries, and bring that in to make your sport better.
You make me feel so smart.
So you're doing a great job. This is my pat on the back to you.
Thank you. I think I am a pretty smart chick, and I'm highly motivated. Other than that, that's where it stops. Other than that, I think that saying that I'm somebody super, super special, I'm a special individual because I have a really great supportive family that told me that I could go land on the moon if I wanted to. And I think that not everybody has got that advantage. And if you don't have that advantage, make it for yourself. I know a lot of people that have, you know, limiting beliefs about themselves, or their parents are not supportive, or their boyfriend or husband or whatever their situation may be. But just make up for it somewhere else. Because every one of us has got a story of some sort. Anything you do with fervor and passion and consistency, you will outdo the smart guy in the room. Most billionaire geniuses statistically have dyslexia or some other kind of learning disability. And while I don't have any of those, I've got a lot of things that, you know, I dropped out of college before I finished all my degrees. Different things that I did, not that I encourage that, but you can pass the Harvard grad. Just by putting in a lot more time and finding a lot more free information. Information is literally everywhere.
So I've got one here from Shania LaReeve. So sorry if I just screwed up your name. She says, I'm supposed to have goals, but when I don't reach those and I'm disappointed. For instance, if I have a bad run or tip a barrel, how am I supposed to channel my disappointment or anger? I work and put so many hours in my horse and it feels like it slips away with a bad run. It's hard to smile walking back to the trailer.
Step one, failure is a part of your story. You absolutely 1000% cannot win anything without failing first. So, I don't know who paints the fairy tale pictures for everyone that, oh, you're gonna go in there, you're gonna work really hard, and then you're gonna win. But that's just not how it is. You will win. When I won the world, I still lost more rodeos than I won. even when I ended up the world champion at the end of the year, failure is a part of the journey. If you can look at failure differently, that would be your first step to success. Failure means that didn't work. Let's try a new experiment. When I hear about the quote that's always so misconstrued that, oh, well, insanity is trying something over and over again. Even my mom told me that when she was like, I'm just doing the same thing over and over again. Don't do the same thing over and over again. If you're constantly doing X, Y, Z and you're failing, tweak one thing every week. I try to run a new experiment every week. One new thing. What am I going to do this week that's going to be different than I've done any week? When you find something that works a little bit, double down on it. Go harder. So for me, my fulfillment comes from spending every weekend with my parents at a clinic. And you can call me a nerd, a dork, or whatever else, but if I get the most fulfillment and people love seeing me and my clinics sell out in minutes, I'm doubling down on that thing because that's what really brings me joy. If bringing me joy was something else, or if every time I tipped a barrel in competition, I melted down, I would never find the experiment that actually works. So just know that there's somebody somewhere that is hitting a barrel and going, okay, I think that was just circumstantial. And you got to know that too. When is it just circumstance? Like Stormy's horse slipped last night. We are not going to go reinvent the wheel because Knick Knack slipped. We're going to go run her again and change nothing. So that's what we're going to do. And more often than not, you're going to run into that where, you know, the bit flipped up, the reins did something. Going back to the drawing board every single time is not going to help you. You've got to be very consistent. And if you're just 1% better every single time you go in the arena, you're going to be the guy that's 100% better in 100 days. And that does not mean winning every time. It may mean, like last night on Uzi, it meant that my first barrel was great. Second, third weren't that great. But I was 1% better on the first barrel. Progress. We put it away. I changed nothing. I just try to be a little bit better rider the next time. I'm not going to go to the practice pin and do anything different.
Well, I wanted to know, what do you think is the biggest challenge about being on the road?
Money.
Finance.
For most people, it's going to be money. And you're going to put yourself in a bind and bend over backwards because you didn't do the numbers. So everybody gets to a point where they're like, oh my gosh, what am I doing? I think that everyone needs to understand that this is a beautiful hobby. If you look at Olympians, Olympians have the exact same problem. And I have waited for an Olympian to write a book, and there hasn't been one yet. But Olympians don't get paid. They don't. If you're not Michael Phelps, you're not on the front of a Wheaties box. You're not sponsored by Reebok and Nike and Adidas. There are those, you know, those few Fallon Taylors that are actually making it, and the rest of them are struggling. They're putting their family through a lot of stress. They don't have money for anything else. In fact, at the last Olympics, it was asked of 100 Olympians if they could take a drug that would make them win a gold medal that year but would kill them in 5 years, if they would take the drug. 90% of them said yes.
Oh.
So these are people that, wow, their ultimate why is, their ultimate fulfillment is this one thing, and they would do absolutely anything for it. So you have to really understand if you're willing to put your family, friends, spouse, other things on hold for that, because the people that you're competing against would literally die for it. So you've got to be really careful with going into it half-heartedly. If you just really love to compete, you can find plenty of places to go amateur 2 hours down the road that you can do this within your budget. If you ultimately want to be a world champion, that game plan's got to be drastically different, and you've got to be super entrepreneurial.
I think especially someone like me, and maybe a lot of others in my boots right now, who are just trying to piece this together. Like, we're just starting out. My store is going to be coming online really soon.
Hey.
Raindrags.com.
I like that. What is it?
Raindrags.
I like that.
Thanks. So that'll be coming online, and I'm just trying to figure out, you know, how am I going to price things? Will people want to buy these things? Will they find, you know, benefit in the information I have to share? And I think that's really helpful for me to kind of keep in mind, is that people value things that cost money because they understand that it's a transaction, the way that you described it.
Well, why do people buy Louis Vuittons when you can buy the same quality bag for $30? Why do they do that? And it's because they want the significance of it. You know, why would you want to come down here if I let every single person come down here for free and just have a run of the place? There's no exclusivity. I'm not making you feel special. I'm not giving you my time. And there's a thing in this world called reciprocity. If I sell you a $3,500 bag, I'm going to make sure that you love it. Because you've done a lot for me. You paid my bills that day. If I sell you a $30 bag and it gets a little tear in it, I'm going to go, well, hey, cheapskate, that's all you paid for. Keep it moving.
Fallon, thank you so much for answering all of our questions and my Instagram family as well. This has been super insightful and extremely helpful and motivational and uplifting and everything else. Thank you.